Now he has a YouTube channel, Are We Winning, it's called, and when it talks about different things, and among other things, also strategies and strategic questions for the animal rights movement. And you will say more about what you've been doing later, I'm sure. And Ben is based in Berlin, and he is a member of the Anarcho Syndicalist Trade Union Berlin, FAU. Since 2015, he has been organizing the struggle for a new collective agreement for fair wages for the student research assistants at the Berlin universities. And he has also been involved in other campaigns done by the union, and I'm sure also with, has a general view of what many things that are going on in the left scene, I think, in Berlin. Well, you might talk about things apart from that, but like, his main focus is with this union and also this struggle for fair wages against or with the university, and you will explain how that works later. So we'll do it now like this. Jake will talk first for 20 to 30 minutes, then Ben will talk about 15 minutes, both have a presentation, and after that, it's time for your comments, questions, objections, and everything else. So let's start.
Cool, thank you. My name is Jake. I have about a 50-minute presentation. I'm going to squeeze it into 30 minutes, hopefully, so I apologize if I speak a little quickly. I'm going to speak in English because my German is really terrible. But if I'm saying something you don't understand, please just wait with me or do something, and we can figure out where I've gone wrong. So my talk is called A Case for Campaigns, Make a Change Instead of Asking for It. And so, obviously, it's my case for why I think we need to do more strategic campaigning. So, a little bit about me. I moved out of San Francisco, and I live in Seattle. But otherwise, everything's not great. So, I live in the northwest corner of the United States in Seattle, but I work on a few different projects. I work with an organization called Rainforest Action Network, which is an environmental organization that uses pressure tactics, corporate campaigning, and direct action to get corporations to shift policies around climate change, human rights abuses, and rainforest deforestation, particularly palm oil issues in Indonesia. I also work with an organization called the Northwest Animal Rights Network, and we do general animal rights work. And I also do a small group called the Burrito Coalition, where we make vegan food for homeless people and pass it out on the streets of Seattle. So when I think about struggle and when I think about campaign work, I think about this quote by Martin Luther King Jr. I'm hoping everyone's familiar with Martin Luther King Jr.
He said, freedom is never voluntarily given by the oppressor.
It must be demanded by the oppressed. And I think that's a really important quote,
particularly in today's
time, right? At least in the United States. We live in a really dark time in the United States under this Trump regime that is really oppressive to just about anyone and everything within the country, and now just outside of the country. And I think it's a time that we really need to start demanding change. We can't ask for it anymore.
We need to
demand it. And we have to realize that that change is not going to be voluntarily given to us. So, and I think in the animal rights movement, at least, we spend a lot of time trying to convince people one at a time to change their minds, asking them to change the way that they live, the way that they eat, the way that they
live their lives.
And I think we need to start shifting that idea towards more demanding of change from corporations, from industries, from politicians, so forth and so on. And I want to talk about a few examples of how this has worked in the animal rights movement successfully, and also in other movements that we can learn from them,
and hopefully
make some change. So, in the United States, we call it pressure campaigns, or corporate campaigns.
I think in Europe,
sometimes you call it single issue campaigns. But it's the idea of picking a target, whether that's a person, or an industry, or a company, or a sector, and applying pressure to that sector, or that target, so much that they are forced to change. Sometimes they're forced to change because economically it doesn't make sense. Sometimes it's ethically it doesn't make sense.
But what you're
doing is you're kind of finding their weakness,
their Achilles heel,
and you're pressuring it so that they can no longer, to the point where they don't want that pressure anymore, and
they make
the change in order to release that pressure. And the great thing about pressure campaigns is that you utilize every strategic tool in the toolbox. So you're not just concentrating on one tactic, like outreach or protest or letter writing. You use all the different pieces together in order to enact change. And that change can look like a lot of different things. It can be adopting new policies, it can be changing or stopping a process or a practice, or in some cases it can be closing a business or a situation altogether. And to me that's really exciting. The other option is educational outreach campaigns, street advocacy campaigns, stall campaigns. So these kind of campaigns are used to build, are built to inform the public, right? To change public opinion, to maybe expose an institution or a practice,
in an attempt to build,
you know, a stronger, like, massive boycott. We see that in the animal rights movement as veganism. We often see it as palm oil issues, marshes to close slaughterhouses. It's this broad ask of, like, we want you to go vegan, we want you to stop eating palm oil, we want you to close slaughterhouses. And the way that we're going to do that is to educate enough people to change hearts and minds that you would eventually start shifting public awareness and changing things that way. So, whenever I do public presentations, I feel it's necessary to include really embarrassing photos of yourself. So I have three in this presentation here, two of them. But I started out doing a lot of vegan outreach when I was younger. I started working with an organization called Northwest Animal Rights Network, which I have now started working with again. But this was about 1995, 1996. I became vegan. I got involved with the organization. And we did a lot of different things. We did an enormous amount of vegan outreach. So in the upper corner, it's myself with a handful of friends.
We would do outreach like this maybe three or four times a week
for years, right? We would set up tables, we would hand out literature, we show videos on that amazing technological advanced TV. And we did this, you know, it's not much different than what we do today. I mean, it looks cooler now than it did then, but the concept is still the same, right?
Still getting out there
and spreading this message by showing videos, by talking to people, by having conversations. And again, we did this for years. But the other thing we also did was protests. So, one week we would hold a sign in front of like McDonald's, and the next week in front of the first store,
and the next week in front of
like the circus, and hoping that we would be able to make change that way. And I started looking to what was going on in England.
This was
about 1997, and they were doing these really amazing campaigns against
breeders,
people that are breeding animals for vivisection. And I thought, I want to replicate that by picking a place and trying to shut it down. So we started out by this place called Helen's, which was like a clothing store in outside of Seattle, and they were allowing this furrier to come in, and he was allowed to sell furs inside of the store. And we thought, well, let's just pressure the store, and hopefully that we can get this furrier to leave. So we started doing these demonstrations in the right-hand picture. We would do demonstrations outside of the store.
We'd hand out
literature.
We would
sometimes use civil disobedience to get arrested. Sometimes we
lit like weird effigies of
coffins on fire, like in front of the store. And after like 3 or 4 months, they decided they didn't want to put up with protests and literature and fires outside of their store. And they told the warrior had to leave. And that was very exciting. It was successful. Like, we got what we wanted. We achieved
something
that we were all responsible for. And it felt good to win.
We
moved on to this place called the Bon Marché, which is like a department store in the Northwest that sold
clothing, and
they had a fur section in there as well. So we did the same thing. We did protests every week, educational outreach.
We did civil disobedience in this case.
Myself and my friends, we locked ourselves, our necks together with bike locks and laid down in the store and chanted and yelled and caused a disturbance.
They had a tough time removing us
because of the bike locks. That's my little baby face in the corner. That's my second embarrassing picture of the presentation. We started doing home demonstrations at the president of this company, and his wife got mad. She came out
with a garden hose
and sprayed a bunch of protesters with water, and the cops saw it, and they arrested her for some reason for, like, assault with a garden hose, and it became this big story in Seattle where, like, she was going to trial, and it was the animal rights activists versus,
like, you know, the rich CEOs,
you know, family, and like, the whole city was, like, interested in this protest campaign. And yeah, she was found guilty, surprisingly, of, like, misdemeanor assault with water. But the president just did not want that media attention, and he ended up getting rid of her in all the department stores. That was really exciting. So there's all these little successes that we had. And after that, I decided I wanted to help start this organization to shut down
one of the world's
largest animal testing laboratories.
But before
that, I want to talk about the queer campaigns that were going on in England that I was telling you about.
There's so people
in England that were doing the same thing. They were holding signs in front of a first store one day,
the circus next,
McDonald's the next, they wanted to target some place and shut it down. So they found this place called Consort Legal Queers,
which fed bred
dogs for animal laboratories. And they started their research on this place, and they decided they were going to do what's called tertiary targeting,
which is a really successful way of corporate campaigning,
of pressure campaigning. So what
that means
is you're not just protesting against the company you want to change or shut down.
You're protesting against
all the corporations that is associated with that business. So in this
case, instead of just protesting the breeder,
they protested against the people that work there. They protested against
the laboratories that
bought the dogs.
They protested against the companies that
provided dog food to the place, the company that provided dog bedding to the place. So if you could take away all these other pieces, it didn't matter
what the breeder did
because they couldn't survive. So they launched this campaign. They protested against all these people.
They had national demonstrations where they brought, thousands, 2,000 people out of the facility in the middle of nowhere where they were breeding these dogs.
And
they decided, these large national demonstrations,
people would run through the fields, they would come up to the walls, on the other side of the walls,
and hear these
dogs barking.
And they knew
they were
going
to be sent to laboratories. And so they started tearing those walls down literally brick by brick.
Using the
other bricks to smash out the other brick, get over the fences, they would
go
in,
they'd
grab these dogs from the cages,
run off
into the
fields,
and they would do this at their national demonstrations. And after 12 months, the Consort Beagle Breeder shut down, and they handed over 200 beagles to animal rights activists all over the country in England. People were really excited, they realized
that
the power that they had with this pressure campaign, that they could start closing places down. They didn't have to ask
for
politicians to change things,
they didn't
have to.
Pull a lever to
vote for something. They didn't have to write a check to a big organization and say, can you please shut this thing down? They could do it themselves.
They
realized the power that they had with good, strong, smart campaigning and the power they had as individuals that we could do it ourselves. So they moved on to a place called Hillgrove Cat Farm in 1997. It was a place that bred cats for laboratories.
And they
did the same thing.
At tertiary
targeting.
Targeting
all the companies that breeder
did
to stay open.
Repeat the same
thing,
national demonstrations.
They put in thousands of people all over the country to this farm
in the middle
of the fields.
The police would
set up barricades to keep people out. The protesters
would push
barricades
in. They'd
run across the fields towards the farm.
The cops would
come out. They'd
have interactions
with the cops. They'd push their
way through
the cops
and
they'd get to those walls. And they'd
loop
behind the walls with those cats being sent to the laboratories. And they started tearing down the walls. And in this particular, they run in,
grab
the
cats,
run away. In this particular demonstration, the farmer's house was next to the cat barns, and people started throwing rocks at the farmer's house. And so many rocks landed on his
roof
that it started caving in. And after 18 months of this, the farmer Brown said, I can't put up with you animal rights people anymore.
He closed the farm down,
and he turned over 800 cats to animal rights activists all over the country. Now
people were
really excited. Right, what do we do next? They went after Regal Rabbits, a place that bred rabbits. In 7 days, they closed that place, and they
turned
over 1,200 rabbits
to animal
rights activists, and now it's a mushroom farm. They went
after
Shamrock Monkey Farm
bred
primates for laboratories. After 12 months of
protesting,
they shut that place down, and it's been bulldozed over by the company, and that's all that remains. People were really excited to be closing these places down one at a time.
But
the original three people, they wanted to do something
bigger.
And so they found this place called Huntington Life Sciences, or HLS. And HLS is a
contract research
organization. So it's an animal testing laboratory.
They don't
actually create any new products. They
just
test products for other
corporations
that need a third-party testing, if that makes sense. But they
kill
500 animals every day, 180,000 animals a year,
and
have
over
72,000 animals in cages at any given time in three facilities, both in
England
and
also
in the lovely state of New Jersey
in the
United States, which I would
strongly
suggest you skip if you ever visit the United States. New Jersey is a terrible place. All right. The interesting thing about this laboratory,
two
things that were
interesting, made this one different,
is that this place had undercover investigators working inside it at some point. So on video
and pictures
and diaries, they found
that there was really horrific
animal cruelty. policy going on.
There's really
sloppy science where people are falsifying the data to make it look like the research was working when it really wasn't.
The second thing was that
it was a publicly traded company, meaning you could buy and sell shares in the company, and which also meant they had a board of directors that they had to answer to. So all these things could become targets.
And because it was such
a larger corporation, it was the third largest corporation of its kind in the world, it had so many different tertiary targets that they could go after that the campaign was so much bigger and so many more people could be involved in it. So they started this campaign in England. They did all the research the same way
they did the other places.
They went after them really hard. They went after primarily their finances, right? So they started protesting against all these banks that were financing the laboratory.
And they
started removing this laboratory source of income.
To the point
where the laboratory got really scared and were unsure that they were going to be able to stay open. So what they decided to do was move all their finances from England to a place where they decided there was no animal rights movement, and that was in the United States. And that was in about 2000, 2001.
And that's when I just moved from the
West Coast back to the East Coast to help start a group called SHAC USA. So the English group was called SHAC, Stop Huntington Animal Cruelty, and our USA chapter was called Stop Huntington Animal Cruelty
USA,
not the most offensive name, but it was SHAC USA. So we started doing the same type of campaign. We researched anything and everything that was associated with this laboratory in the United States. And we ran it very non-hierarchically. I
think
there was
no
leaders. We had our organization, SHAC USA, and we put out information on how we thought
we could all
close the lab together.
But anyone who wanted to participate
in this campaign could. And they could participate in any way that they wanted.
It was
very horizontally organized. So, that meant like vegans could be involved, vegetarians could be involved, omnivores could be involved, people that would watch these undercover video footage of a beagle puppy being punched in the face who ate meat still could be like, oh my god, that's awful, I want to shut this place down, and we'd say, sure, come on in. But the idea that like once we were involving these folks into the animal rights campaign, they would start realizing that the cat and the dog in the cage were really no different than the pig or the chicken in the factory farm or the mink on the fur farm, and that connection was started to become apparent. So there wasn't a baseline of like, you have to be vegan before you can participate. It was anyone can participate.
Anyone
can care about animals and fight for animals and hope that eventually along the way your diets and lifestyles will change as well. So we started protesting against anyone and everyone
associated with
the laboratory. That looked like a lot of different things. So
people
wrote letters, some people wrote petitions, or just signed petitions, some people sent emails, faxes, and people remember what fax machines are.
We
also did a lot of demonstrations. So there's a lot of demonstrations
at
office buildings. We would protest against these companies that were associated with the laboratory at their places of business. But we felt that a lot of times we were just holding signs outside of a big concrete building and yelling at it, but inside of this building, the people that were making the decisions about whether or not to support this laboratory. So we started,
instead of
yelling at these buildings, we decided to go into the buildings and do office demonstrations. So we would go into offices, and we would chow and
bring
horns and signs and leaflets, and we'd cause ruckus and cause problems, and then we would run away. And just to be clear, I'm not saying necessarily I did these things, but the broader animal rights movement in the United States, all these small groups
scattered
around the country that were working on this campaign and organizing themselves non-hierarchically in this campaign structure. But we also felt that those people inside the offices got to go home at the end of the night to their homes, and also the laboratory said we'd be there 24 hours a day.
So we decided to do home demonstrations. So people go to people's homes,
and they have leaflets and banners and bullhorns and do demonstrations,
which is
controversial, but in the United States, for the most part, it's legal, it's allowed. So we did that, and we would go anywhere and everywhere these people were, right?
We'd
go to their trade organizations, their trade meetings, we'd
go to
their golf retreats. Some people would go to like train stations where they
knew the
employees waited for the trains to go to work, and they would hand out leaflets and be like, that's the guy, so forth and so on. There was also an element of like
legal
action as well. So
people would
engage in civil disobedience. Sometimes they would lock themselves to doors,
or
they
hang
banners from the roof, or sometimes they would dress up like a giant rabbit, or sometimes they do all those things at the same time. I'm not sure why. But any way to apply pressure to these companies. And
There was also an underground
element as well. This wasn't something we organized or asked for or funded, but it was just
what happens
when there's a large animal rights movement that people want to engage in illegal underground actions. So groups like the Animal Liberation Front started becoming active in the campaign.
They would
do acts of vandalism, like spray paint buildings or smash windows. Sometimes they would target laboratories or breeders specifically because they were involved with aquatics and life sciences.
So this case, they broke
into a breeding facility and rescued 30 dogs, and said, we came there because you are associated with the laboratory. They went after laboratories that were hiring Huntington Life Sciences to do research for them, and in this case, they broke in, and I think they rescued like 110 chickens, and said, we did this because you're associated with the laboratory.
I know I'm speaking very fast,
so I apologize. I'm trying to cram it on it, but it was very, very exciting, right?
It was
a point where, like, we were pulling these bricks out of the foundation of this laboratory, one of the world's largest laboratories. We would push this against their bank, against their insurance company, against their internet provider, against the people that were putting food in their cafeterias and the toilet paper in their bathrooms. Like, anything and everything was a target. And as we could pull one of these bricks out of their foundation, we could get the bank to pull out, or their insurance company to drop their insurance contracts. The laboratory could not find a bank fast enough to replace it, or an insurance company fast enough to replace it. And the whole foundation, the whole laboratory crumbled. So as I said, you could buy a share of this laboratory on the stock market. And at the beginning of the campaign, the share price was worth about $30. And at the height of the campaign, it was worth about 2 or 3 cents.
It's incredibly
successful. So I think a lot of that exciting activism also sometimes leads to some police repression, the state becoming more interested in you. And so we had a lot of that too. There's a lot of surveillance, a lot of being followed. Garbage man was let pay to keep our trash separate. You know, all these different ways the government was trying to figure out how we were organizing all this stuff. So they tapped our phones, they recorded thousands and thousands of minutes of, tens of thousands of minutes of phone conversations. They used pen tracers to monitor what we were doing on the internet. We were the first organization in the United States where the government tried to hack into our computers using malware to try to figure out what our passwords were. They used infiltrators to come into our office and act like animal rights activists, so forth and so on. Eventually, they
raided
our house, they took everything, they built a case against us, they arrested us. This is a super short version. And they all this stuff happened. It was exciting.
I'll tell you about it.
And then there was a guy by the name of Christie. I don't know if people follow U.S. politics, but he's a really awful politician. I guess he's not a politician anymore, right? I think he's out of office now. But
he's not.
Which is cool. He ran against Trump and lost to Trump. That's all you know. But he was the prosecutor in our case before he got into, like, presidential elections. And he gave a press conference when he arrested us. And they arrested seven people around the country that they thought were the leaders of this movement. And he said, we've removed seven uncivilized members of an otherwise civilized society, which is one of the best quotes I've ever had, said about me to myself. So, we were sentenced to a variety of different, or were charged with a variety of different charges. As I said, there were seven of us. They dropped the charges against one person and added the organization SHAC USA. So
six people in the organization.
That formed SHAC 7. And that also formed my third embarrassing photo of the night. It is this one of the SHAC 7. So in the United States, they often say, like, you can win over a judge and a jury by, like, dressing really nicely and, like, looking like a nice person. But I can tell you that my pink shirt and yellow tie got me, like, absolutely nothing. We were all charged with a variety of different crimes. They charged all of us, though, with what was a law called the Animal Enterprise Protection Act, which is now called the Animal Enterprise Terrorism Act.
And what
this law says is if you cross a state line, so in the United States there are 50 states, if you cross from one state to another, and you disrupt a business that uses animals, and you do more than $10,000 worth of physical damage, they can essentially try you as a domestic terrorist.
And what the intent
was to stop people from driving from state to state and raiding fur farms and laboratories. But in our case, what they said is that we crossed state lines to the internet because we used our webpage and email to organize.
And we did more than
$10,000 for the economic damage because we kept that share price. And therefore, they could try us as domestic terrorists. We fought it in court,
and of course, when you fight government,
you always lose. So, just kidding, there's open to that too. So we were all found guilty. We were all sentenced to a variety of charges. I was sentenced to 4 years in prison. I did that in Southern California. That's a whole other awful talk that you can find on YouTube if you're interested. Prison's not a fun place. I would not suggest going there, no matter what country you live in. So I think that this type of activism, this type of campaigning, while it has its ups and it has its downs, I think it can be wildly successful if used correctly in really interesting ways. And I think we can see just about every social justice movement, except the animal rights movement, uses pressure campaigns in really important ways and successful ways. But in the animal rights movement, we stick primarily to encouraging people to do lifestyle change and individual change by just doing outreach. But I think we see these things happen in other movements that I think we can look back on and we can learn from. And just to go through a couple of them really quickly, I think the U.S. Civil Rights Movement is a really big inspiration to me. And I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with it. But basically, the main goal of the Civil Rights Movement in the United States was that people of color would be treated equally, equitably, they would be treated as human beings, and they wanted their liberation. And so they worked to achieve that by a lot of small little steps, by doing essentially pressure campaigning towards that final goal of civil rights, of liberation. So one of the examples I like to use is the bus boycotts in the 1950s. So in the Deep South, or in the South, there was laws that basically segregated black folks from white folks. So black folks had their own water fountain. They had to use different water fountain. They had to sit in the back of the bus. They had to sit in different sections of restaurants. They were segregated from white folks. And so on the buses, black folks could sit wherever they wanted, but as soon as a white person came on, they had to get up and move to the back of the bus. And so they wanted to use this segregation as a pressure campaign to put enough pressure on the government to change the law and then start integrating different pieces of the South. So it kind of kicked off with Rosa Parks. So people familiar with Rosa Parks? She was a woman that got on the bus. She refused to give her a seat up for a white man. The cops came in, they arrested her, and it made international news. She was on the front page in the New York Times being arrested. It was a really big deal, and it kicked off this bus boycott. And the interesting thing I think about Rosa Parks was that, like, this was a very strategic plan to action, right? She trained for months for this. She had been arrested a bunch of times in the past and trained people on nonviolent civil disobedience. And this was kind of one more, like, feather in their hat, so to speak. But they built it as, like, this woman just got on the bus and she just wanted to go for a ride on the bus. And it worked. Like, that tactic and that strategy, like, boosted the bus boycotts and made it huge. And after about 11 months of folks boycotting the bus, buses in the South, they changed the law where they had to integrate the buses. But the law was never really enforced, right? So the Deep South, they were like, yeah, we'll go with this law, we're not actually going to enforce it. So that's when organizers from the North decided they were going to come and support the folks in the South.
So they would do things called freedom rides,
where black and white folks could get on the bus and say integrated in the North, they'd ride the buses into the South to challenge the laws. And it was a really dangerous thing because when they arrived in the South, the Ku Klux Klan, the KKK, were associated and friends with the cops, and the cops basically said to the Klan, we'll give you 15 minutes of buses before we show up. And so the Klan attacked these buses as they're coming into the South.
This one
particular case, they put the firebombs into the bus and then held the door shut to try to burn the people alive on the inside. Eventually, the people got out. A lot of people were beaten and attacked, and it was obviously a really terrible and awful situation. But what that did was that it made international news. Like, the idea that, like, the South was so segregated that the Klan and the cops were working together to try to kill activists made it a visual that the federal government could no longer ignore. And so after about a year or so, the freedom rides, people riding buses from the Northeast, like New York and Washington, D.C. and San Francisco, and trying to ride buses all the way to the Deep South to New Orleans, the federal government moved in basically with the military and integrated the South. So not just the buses, but also the restaurants and the water fountains, the black-only signs and the white-only signs came off the walls, and slowly, the South was slowly starting to become integrated. small little pressure campaigns. I got a couple minutes left, but I really want to talk about this other protest campaign that I think was really important that happened a couple years ago in the environmental movement against the Keystone Pipeline, or the KXL Pipeline, which was a big pipeline project that was trying to pull tar sands, this really nasty oil from Alberta, Canada. This Canadian company wanted to build a pipeline through the United States down to the Gulf of Mexico in the south, put it on ships, and ship it to China. And so they managed to build portions of the pipeline when they were going to build the fourth and final piece to the south. Enough people were like, this has got to stop, this is crazy. Like, this can't happen for a variety of reasons, but particularly because Keystone Pipeline has a really terrible track record. Their pipelines always leak. This is running through really important environmental lands for the environment, for the animals, and for indigenous communities and local communities. They were just this pipeline project. Like all pipeline projects, needed to be stopped. So a campaign was launched to stop
that fourth and
final piece. And it was really exciting because it started out as this kind of direct action campaign, but it galvanized and inspired people all across the country. And people rallied around this campaign to become a part of it. And it really brought together interesting allies, right? It wasn't a campaign that was like only environmentalists can work on it. All sorts of people started working on it. Radical environmentalists, like Earth First folks, indigenous communities, cowboys, environmentalists from NGOs, clergy members and priests, civil rights members, everyone came together to fight this pipeline. And in Texas, they plotted out where this pipeline was going to go. And so some more radical folks got there early. They set up these camps in the trees. They set up houses and platforms. They had, like, cables running from tree to tree so they could, like, pulling themselves back and forth. They hung this like amazing banner, which I love. And they basically were there. So when the bulldozers came to raise the ground and lay the place where the pipe was going to go, they couldn't because these people were in the trees. And it started to kind of gum up the works, right? So people weren't able to continue with the work and slow the work down. At the same time, people would run into the work zones and they would use lock boxes to lock themselves into the bulldozers so the bulldozers couldn't run. And they would shut down the work zone for the day. People would run through the facility and the work zones and like camouflage and just like run and cause problems and
run into the woods,
camouflage and like hide from the cops. It's anything and everything to slow this process down. But at the same time, there's also like a larger NGO environmental world that was also organizing and rallying and getting a movement together to resist the pipelines. So my work at Rainforest Action Network with another one or two organizations, we came up with something called the Pledge of Resistance, where it was like an online thing that anyone could sign up for.
And we just said, if you are willing to like
throw down to stop this pipeline, like get arrested, engage in like nonviolent civil disobedience, just be active against this pipeline, please sign up. And in less than a year, we had 97,000 people around the country say, I will be arrested to stop this pipeline. And they weren't active, some of them were, but like, there were just everyone from all walks of life that were so upset about this pipeline project that they were like, I will do anything to shut this thing down. And it made people very excited to be part of this bigger and broader movement. And so then became the other task of like, how do you organize and train 97,000 people who have never done civil disobedience before to do civil disobedience. So we used this thing called the snowflake method, where you would have like a core group of people, so in this case it was core people from Rainforest Action Network, and then we would go into communities around the country and organize organizers. We would train trainers. Instead of trying to train 97,000 people, we would train all the trainers, and then those trainers would go into their communities and train activists. And so like snowflake branching out, we were able to organize and train an enormous amount of people that within a year we had 100,000 people ready to go. And so when it was important to have pressure on someplace, on that pressure point, along the way, whether it was a pipeline company or a bank or the federal government that was working to make this happen, we could call up a place like in Chicago and be like, hey, we need to go to a demonstration.
And you get 23 people showing up,
having a sit-in for the federal building, getting arrested, but make a bunch of news. And it wasn't just activists, right? It was like young kids and grandmothers. There's a priest in the upper right corner. It was all sorts of people. In the bottom right-hand corner, there was this grandmother in Texas. She was part of the sit-in there, and she got arrested. was exciting. People realized the power that they had as individuals and as part of a broader campaign. They can make change. Eventually got brought all the way to President Obama, decided that he was going to reject the permit to build that fourth piece. And at this point, it still is not given the green light to go ahead. So, that being said, I realize I just said an awful lot really quickly, so I apologize. But I think they're great examples of how pressure campaigns have been used all over the world in a variety of different movements to get what they want.
They're
changing in the environment.
They're
reshaping banking sectors. They're reshaping the way that industries operate around things that we are opposed to, destruction of the environment, killing of the natural world, the 72 billion animals that are killed every year so that people can eat them and use them in entertainment. But in the animal rights movement, we try to do these same type of things by amassing these numbers of people by just going to people one at a time. And just asking, hey, can you change your lifestyle? Can you change the way that you eat? What do you eat? The way that you engage in entertainment or things that you wear? And one at a time, I just don't think, you know, trying to persuade people one at a time to become vegan, I think it's a really difficult task to achieve the things that we need to achieve. And ultimately, I think that, like, if we make vegans, we're not necessarily making campaigners, right? Not making activists. But if we make activists, I think we'd eventually start making campaigners. If we start making activists, we'll eventually start making vegans. And I think that's a really important thing to think about the animal rights movement. Because often we set this moral baseline where if you want to be part of the animal rights movement, if you want to say that you care about animals, you first have to be vegan. You first have to reach this level of like acceptance by the rest of the movement before you're allowed to proceed into protesting. And I think that's a detriment to our movement because there are millions and millions and millions of people in the world that care about animals,
but they
eat them too. And that's weird, and it's weird to say, but it's true. We can harness the power from of those folks that want to fight for animals. I think, as I said before, they eventually get the concept of the laboratory vehicle is just the same as the chicken in the farm, and just the same as the mink in the fur farm, and just the same as the elephant in the circus, and it starts to make sense. And
I think we can grow bigger movements that way, and I think we can
also grow more vegans that way.
And eventually,
really be a positive force for animals. Because in order to win animal liberation, like, we have to change every fabric of society in everyone's lives. We have to change the way people eat food. We have to change the clothing people wear. We have to change the entertainment that they watch. We have to change the medicine that they take. And all of that applies to the vegans too, right? Every vegan, whether you think about it or not, like all of our food, all of our vegetables, all of our fruits, all the cotton clothes we wear, the synthetic clothes we wear, all the products that we take that aren't tested on animals, in one way or another, they also kill animals, right? So animal liberation is like the biggest and loftiest goal of social justice movements that really has like ever been attempted, right? I mean, it's massive. And so like if we're really going to win this massive, massive goal, like, I think we need to be really smart, we need to be creative, and we need to take risks. We need to build pressure campaigns to start shifting corporations and start shifting industries and start shifting sectors and instead of trying to ask one person at a time to change. And because I think at the end of the day, like, we can no longer just ask for that change, but we also, we're going to have to start demanding it. So that's the end of my portion. I went 7 minutes and 26 seconds over, so I apologize. But I went as fast as I could. But thanks for entertaining me, and I'm looking forward to what's next.
I'm Ben from FAU building. I didn't really know the context where this talk would take place, so do you know FAU building, or who has ever heard of that organization? Well, half the people, okay. Is anybody of you a member of FAU building? Into a discussion. I thought that, like, the general title of that talk would be that it's on the one hand about how we pick our fights and how we want to shape our places by engaging in those fights. And the general situation, sorry, I didn't get an English version of about the German union landscape, so but here's some graphics from Schmitz Online where they show that the amount of union members in Germany has declined radically in the last 20, 25 years, and it's still declining, so it's about 15% by now. And especially among leftists in Berlin, or radical leftists, unions also have like a difficult time because there are most of you are familiar with the German union system, I think. Like we have some big social democratic unions which have about like 5 million members in the whole of Germany combined, like of the 80 million people living here. And they dominate the union business in a way, many leftists, radical leftists, are not so happy about how those unions operate, and our union at FAU Berlin is like fishing in that waters of leftists who are not so happy about how the big unions work. And some other thing that is funny in this graphic is that it says about how much people are striking. It's 5 days. Yeah, but 1,000 employees. So to translate the numbers, if an employee works for 200 years, they'll strike one day. So the one day in 200 years is how much an average employee in Germany strikes. And we are of course people want to increase that number. We still are part of the union movement, so we aren't shaming the other unions for not striking. We actually also don't strike that much for now, because we want to grow and then be able to grow on the other side. Just a quick graphic that usually isn't explained in more detail if you come to our introductory events, which are open, where you all can get a lot more details about it. We have a multi-layer system where we have an international level where there's unions in every country, and but actually we are a group of many small unions, syndicates, which operate on local level or maybe also only for single industries in special cities, and which are federated at a regional and federal like national level and then on an international level. FAU Berlin, FAU Berlin itself has workplace groups and working groups and sections, like for example for health, education, media, and section for members who don't have German as their mother language. They have to work together like as a grassroots organization with the General Assembly, where most of the decisions are made and people are mandated to do special stuff of organization. But who's familiar with the Anarcho Syndicalism? Because lots of what you talked about was also has a connection to how Anarcho Syndicalism works originally. But what we are trying to do is also form a real organization, like not just campaigns, but more state organizations with real structure and people who have to take certain responsibilities for the organization with launches. And I don't really want to bother you with all the details about how I think it works, but about to show how we make this into campaigns. Because at the moment we have like 400 members in Berlin, and okay, the title of this event today is about taking it up with corporations, but at our size, we don't usually fight against corporations, but usually against small left-wing businesses. But so we are leftists, and I think it's cool that leftists run left businesses. We organize left workers, and left workers often work at leftist places, and for some reason, they still have workers' rights, and there still is some antagonism between the leftist bosses and the leftist workers. So, like, one of the most famous circles was at the small cinema in Berlin, the Kino, which is also connected to the leftist party in Germany. And, like, lots of people know this, so that therefore I thought I would include it in this presentation. And you might also misunderstand how circles are born. Our circles are always one halfway. Like that one, for example, was one in the way that Verdi, one of the big trade unions, entered the conflict and said, okay, we'll negotiate collective agreement. And it also was heavy, like, now he can negotiate with a real union. Like, that's actually what he said. Like, yeah, but now I have a real union. Even though Verdi only had one member in the shop, whereas we had a dozen or something. But still then they bind a collective agreement, and so there were improvements for the people working there, but it wasn't us who were then signed the collective agreement. Still, it had its effects, like pushing for the pressure on the boss and his friends, and it improved the work working conditions for the people. Some other thing where we took it up with some big enemy or like antagonist was the Mall of Berlin. Many people wonder that, I think. Okay, because there was some situation where the mall was built by lots of construction workers from Eastern Europe, and there was
a somewhat
chaotic situation on the site, and nobody knew who would work for whom, because they only had oral contracts, they didn't have written contracts, and at some point the workers didn't get more money. Like, they continued to work, but nobody, most of the people who usually would have their money, is still sending them their money, and then some of the workers went homeless because they couldn't pay their rent. And after 4 months or something, they started to build a real campaign with our help that they want to get their to receive their the money that they are owed. That's interesting because it's meant at first for us to find ways for those workers to survive. Like, this is also some like they were homeless, basically, and like FAU members then had to find places in their flats where the workers could live so that they could take up the fight, because the workers had to be that problem addressed before one could fight. And then there were migrant workers who wanted to go back to their own countries or to other countries where they could work on. This conflict started at the end of 2014, but it isn't over yet. Like, we won lots of court cases, because actually it's, I mean, at least from the standpoint of the German law, it's also quite obvious that workers should be paid if there's a contract, and judges also agree to this, which is cool, but it still takes a lot of time. There's this strange tendency of all the companies against which we win in this court case, that they always get go bankrupt the next day.
And that's
why this court case goes on and on. And at the moment, we are trying to get a high level court ruling that the main the guy at the end builds, or not the guy, but his company who owns the final mall, that he or the company has to step in and pay the workers. So what is it that obviously yes. one can mess around with migrant workers a lot because they can't really fight on their own here, and we hope that, that
we
know that our collective work there helps them to win the case and get some money. So it's about like 30,000 euros for all of them combined. And fighting 4 years for 30,000 euros actually isn't economic from a union point of view. It's more like economic from the point of view that you annoy your opponent a lot because there's always new media attention and always new bad press for them all because they saved a few thousand euros. Like also from their point of view, 30,000 euros isn't really a lot of money. It's more about the principle and at the end of the day. Don't tell me that's a little bit. Yeah, and then now we have a new collective agreement, which will be signed by the other unions, hopefully this fall. And finally, I thought I'd include this first thing where we try to take it up. Well, before things are too late with a big player, because usually well, lots of our complaints have to do with, okay, somebody wasn't paid or something is really bad at the workplaces, and then we try to fix it afterwards and say, oh, we still owe some money to our people. With Fedora and Lahoo, we try to do organizing before it's too late, because like there are bad working conditions, but those are still emerging businesses in Berlin, and they can still make a difference in how works organized they are. That's also quite difficult, actually, but I don't know if it's also something where lots of other unions take interest, and we did it because Wobblies in the UK is a comparable campaign where you also can see that those anarcho-syndicalist unions and leftist unions also can do something on a bigger scale, because lots of our friend unions started campaigns like that at the same time all over Europe, but we're still moving forward to make things better at those places of Deliveroo and Fedora. And
what
those fights have come in a way is that it's always about part-time jobs and jobs with limited time, so that's, at least in the German labor market, it's not supposed to be like that. All the laws are made for people who are working full-time and without temporal limitations to their contracts. But the labor market changed and the laws have changed, and that's why the landscape of how workers organize in Germany shifts, and the unions can get adapted to it, and especially the big unions have a tough time adapting to this new situation. This is like that gap we are pushing into with FAU Berlin. Actually, not because we plan to do it like that, but because our members work there and we become active where our members work. I also have some problems, like, because you were so attentive that way of going after people and annoying them. That's, for example, one of the big business parts of the Mall of Berlin constructors. And he also organized, I don't know the English word, obviously, a horse race events or something like that, and members of outside of Berlin, and people also over there following him and also showing partners at festivals and races. And that actually was a time when he started also sending his lawyers against us, because apparently this is an appointment. There's also like almost always people who don't agree with us and their lawyers, which is also one of the things, because why it's good to have a more formal organization so that one can really deal with those companies and so
on. What
are the general principles of that behind what we are doing? Maybe you saw that we have some pluralism, that we follow different strategies at the moment, which isn't really like the old fashioned syndicalist way. Like, obviously, we still say that direct actions should be the main focus of our work, but then again, we also go for legal actions if we feel that this is also a good way to annoy the companies and to make them behave in ways the workers would like. Then the other main anarcho-syndicalist idea are shop level groups, which is like that you organize per workspace, per workplace, and have groups there. But whereas in Germany there are those work houses, or I don't know, that's the translated between state, which which translates as work councils, but which is a special German institution which is guaranteed by the law, which is not a union construct, but another way of keeping the relationship between workers and employers in check. And actually, an expert is always opposed to that mechanism, but for example, our health and social services branch now has some people who have been elected to their work councils because actually in their industry, I don't know how to call it an industry, in their industry is apparently a good mechanism to work. We have open campaigns like where usually we want to have real union members engaging in campaigns, but we know, for example, with Deliveroo and Deliveroo are also great for campaigns where we cooperate also with riders who don't want to join a union because today everybody, like nobody wants to join organizations anymore. We go for collective agreements, which is actually, which is cool, but one has to have a certain size in Germany to go for collective agreements. But the opponent is also small and can go for the power size. I thought that I didn't do it. We have a collective agreement with the SPURGO.de that's like at least vegan bodybuilders in Berlin apparently don't know it. Like, if you order some vegan bodybuilder equipment at their store, some unionized workers will, with the collective agreement, will deal with your order. So, then the other classical and anarcho-syndicalist ideas to reorganize how companies work as collectives. And there we have that union call as a new way of institutionalizing how collectives, companies work. For example, Dr. Poo was part of it. Which there's also collectives, like collectives, but the problem with those collectives is that over time they stop being real collectives, and then at some point, there's in a way they still call themselves collectives, but then they will have bosses actually if one looks closely. And so we try to establish mechanisms so that collectives remain collectives in Berlin, and that's what will hopefully spare us some conflicts in the future if we have some institutionalization of that, for example, at Dr. Bolo. And the idea behind this is that how we organize our struggles and how we organize our work should be somewhat the same, like that federation of structure with build solidarity and cooperation and democracy in the union should also be the way the economy is run, and we want to have the same mechanisms in place in both, and that's why we actually want to have collectives and still fight with the corporations and companies which don't work according to those rules. And then we can always pick bigger fights and shape the power of the workplaces around, and then have to fight fewer fights and hopefully can transform how businesses are conducted in Berlin.
Just to connect these talks again, I would like to ask one question. I thought I would ask it to both of you, but actually in the end you almost said the answer already, because my question would have been, what is the bigger picture to both of you? So like, you both explained how certain campaigns, oppression campaigns, can achieve certain goals, but then, the main question is, how can we, by using these particular campaigns, achieve the bigger goal, and does it actually build up to some bigger movement? And I think in your case it's rather clear, I think, but at least if we assume that you as an organization row and row, and the whole struggle grows. So then you transform one workplace after the other, and at the end you have all of them, ideally. So that's the bigger picture, right? And so I wonder, how would you describe this bigger picture, and how you would say that these campaigns add up to something bigger? Because I think there might be an additional problem, which is that you have one corporation, for example, then the other corporations benefit, for example. That's a typical criticism, right? And then because you always have this competition between different corporations, so how do you actually get them all in the end?
Yeah, I think it takes a lot of time to do that, but I think it does work in the long run. I see this a lot in the environmental movement, where in the environmental movement it's a lot about changing policies and corporations. And so a lot of times it's starting campaigns against like the top 5 companies that do this one thing, or top 10 companies that do this one thing. And then you go after really pressure. Usually you knock off some
easy ones really quick. Companies
that are just like, I don't want to be associated with animal cruelty, or I don't want to be associated, you know, with this, that, the other thing. And so then you can switch and change policies or change what they're doing really
quickly.
But then you go after the very top one, and then you go after the biggest one and the hardest one. And sometimes that can take months, sometimes it can take years.
But if you
can get that one large corporation to change, whether that's policy change or change what they're doing entirely, every other company that is his competitor wants to
end up looking as good
as that first company.
I think eventually like they do
start to fall in line. I've seen that a lot in the environmental movement.
It's
a little bit different than the animal rights movement, because I think there's much more of a hardline like approach of like we want animal liberation or nothing. But I think in the environmental movement, it's like if you want, you know, a food company to not use palm oil anymore, for instance, you can take the top
10 corporate
food companies that use terrible palm oil.
You
can pressure that first one to shift and
don't
no longer use palm oil or not source palm oil from certain areas, and that makes that company look good. And so all the smaller companies want to look as good as their top competitor, and they change. And it happens quite regularly. It's
kind of
using the capitalism again, so in a way, which I think is kind of cool.
Okay, questions from all of you. Objections and ideas. And again, if you maybe the best I can get these out. Yeah, if you don't want to ask the question in English, you can write the question down in English or in German and give them to Tom, who's sitting in the corner, and he will translate them for you and ask them. Yeah, how we do it with the people have to talk with this?
So I'm also in the group chief leadership, and I'm very glad how you both complemented each other. I don't know if that's why, but you said that it's inspiring, but it can also be very overwhelming. In the end, you said, like, oh, there's 100,000 people. That's not how I imagine myself organizing in the near future. And I do really like the comparison to you talking about things you do in the city where you live and with a couple of people. So that's very nice to have different approaches, or small and big approaches to sort of change. And I really liked your presentation. I have a couple of questions. I start with one. One.
You can ask as many as you want.
I'll stop after one, then maybe come back. To Penny. So you say, like Jake said, they started with 3-4 people and made a huge campaign. And you have, what you said feels like you you think you don't have enough people, or you know you don't have enough people to do big campaigns. And I wonder why that is, because you have a different approach. You don't want to shut something down, but you want everybody to agree on something that makes things better for everyone. I don't know if that's harder than to just run down a company or something. And I know that there, since the FAU, and there's a lot of international anarcho-syndicalist unions, if there ever have been plans to do an international campaign against one corporation, or if you think the idea is there and some of their talks about it.
Our problem, but also something that is quite cool about us, at least from my point of view, is that we only become active where we have members, and we would only go for negotiations about a collective agreement with a company about half the workforce is a member or synthesizer of our organization. And that's why, with a few thousand anarcho-syndicalists in Europe, unless we all join the same company, we are at no point where we would negotiate with an international corporation, because we would never, at the moment, organize half of their workforce. That's the other reason why we do small businesses and build it, because that's where we can organize half, like the FAU building can organize half of the workforce of one business here. And this is about not wanting to be speak on behalf of somebody else. So we spot to speak on behalf of the workforce of the place, we want to have a major part of the workforce actually joining our ranks and participating in the discussion. I already showed you some counter example with student research assistants in Berlin, where also other unions said that they want to make a campaign, and where obviously all the unions combined, but FAU alone also was never near organizing half the student research assistants in Berlin, but we said, we have members who are student research assistants, and we want to improve their working condition, and it seems to be easy to do this by joining that fight and improving that struggle for a new collective agreement for the student research assistants. Even though we usually would say that we want to have 4,000 student research assistants before we say, as a members of FAU or synthesizers or part of the process, before we say that we negotiate a new collective agreement for 8,000 student research assistants. That deals if you are fine with having 1,000 to 2,000 of the 8,000 and then negotiating a new agreement, and then we use that set out, okay, let's so join the fight then. This also anyway,
I have a follow-up question to that. So it sounds like you think it's very hard to get a lot of people, at least half of someone interested in kind of the same topic, to agree on something, which is depressing, I think, because that's what they were going to try to do with the whole humanity, to get them to agree on not eating animals and not abusing animals. But another question I should ask some intersectional question, no? But I didn't write any of that down. Another question is that I had a feeling that maybe the FAU is more good at to keep activists, because your activists are members of your organization, but you still try to be non-hierarchical. Now, in the end of life movement and other social movements, I have a feeling that a lot of people drop out after a couple of years being in the movement.
and also what you talked about, you talked about huge changes, Jake, and in the beginning when you were talking about people like having success, and they felt like, yeah, let's go on to the next one, but in the next success, like the pipeline, the company decides to build a fourth part, will there be a week ahead there again, or are they gone, or did they, after the success of the pipeline, did they shift to another social movement, or did we lose them, that kind of idea? That kind of question always happens, social movements.
Also, I would always ask how far people, like what you were talking about, like getting random people kind of sucked into something, far they get, like they drop out, they have a different approach to society, like think more political. That's not what you meant. But
I think I can answer a couple questions. If I may?
I think in the animal rights movement, I would argue that the reason that people drop out regularly after a couple of years is because there are no successes. There's no tangible like excitement. I think people stuck around the SHAC campaign, they stuck around in these other campaigns because they liked winning. Like everyone likes to win. No one likes to lose. Or I'm saying I hate to lose. I probably hate to lose more than I like to win. But, like, I want to win at every cost. And I think everyone wants to feel that. And if we don't give them opportunities to win, even if there's small little steps along the way,
I think people are
going to get fed up.
And I mean, like I was saying at the beginning of the talk,
I started doing animal rights in 1995, I think, in 1996. And like, 99.9% of the people that did activism in the 90s are not activists anymore. And a lot of them aren't vegan anymore. And even just then,
doing so much
outreach, all those people in that picture I showed,
none of those people are vegan
or interested in animal rights anymore, except for me. My point is like, all those people just
were
like,
it didn't feel good
to like handle it with someone and talk to someone and try to convince them
and just find out
that like they didn't care, and it just gets exhausting after a while. But I think like what you're saying, when you bring people in that aren't politicized and you politicize them, yeah, I think like some people are going to drop out and some people are going to stick around.
But
the example with the Russia resistance, where we got like 97,000 people to sign on, a lot of those people, a bunch of those people, particularly in the northwest corner of the United States,
when there
wasn't a lot for them to do against this pipeline, they were like, let's just start our own group now. And then they just started their own grassroots radical like groups, and they're still around like years later doing amazing work. And in fact, and, like I would argue, like in the grassroots climate justice movement, like the Northwest has some of the most amazing groups doing the most amazing things. And a lot of those people were just people that had never done activism before, and they got politicized
by joining
this pleasure resistance and fighting the pipeline. And they got so excited about it, and then seeing that win, where Obama said he was not going to allow it to happen, they like that success, and so they wanted more, and so they started a group. Now they've done like all sorts of amazing things over the last couple of years.
So I think like
anything, like you win some and you lose some, but if you don't have any opportunities to win, you're always going to lose. So,
the thing. That is a top-line union, in a way. Like, usually, the unions are professionals who, like, spend their career working for the union. Whereas an anarcho-syndicalist always opposed that idea that, like, no, the people should do their own fights, but obviously the people also still have their families and their hobbies and their work, and they can't do anything more. It's completely normal that all right people spend a few hours a week for the union for some time and then drop out for a while, but many people also return, like at least in FAU Berlin, they stay members, and like when there's a new struggle where they feel like joining, they'll join. It's still, we are still, well, because like the modern
FAU Berlin has like 10 years of existence now, for much of like there was a generation shift 10 years ago. So we still have to try out new mechanisms of how we can re-educate people, but this happens all the time that people stop being active and then return. And I hope that for animal rights or maybe they don't return for the animal rights struggles, but I hope that people who became active at some point still join new struggles, even if they are part of formal organizations that politicizing people actually has effect, even if you have the feeling that they broke out. At least I hope so.
I have two questions for DJ.
Is it on?
Yeah. Okay. One is for when you talked about campaigns against the cat and monkey and unicorns, were you part of that? Partly?
No.
No? Okay. But maybe you know something about it. Was there when you told the story about how the roof of the farm broke down and took all the people into their homes, and I'm wondering, is there like an internal, can you call it codex or something, where you within the organization say, or within the campaign organizers say that we start at assaulting people or really hurting people, or is there like a line you draw that you don't want to cross when it comes to that?
Yeah, I can only speak to like the campaigns that we're on, but for us, the way we would always approach, we got over 100 corporations from the smallest to some of the biggest in the world to agree not to do business with this laboratory anymore.
And we approached every single company
the same way. We would go to them and say, this is the company you're invested in, you're invested in this laboratory. This is the problems we have in it, both from an economic standpoint and an ethical standpoint. Like, it's not
good.
An investment, but also it's a terrible thing that's happening, animal cruelty, so forth and so on. And we are happy to talk with you about it.
We can talk to you about it. We can
get an ethicist to come to talk to you about it. We can get a theologian, like from a religious perspective.
We can get an economist,
like anyone you want to speak to about this situation.
We'll bring them to your office
anywhere in the world and have a discussion with you. We always felt the best way was to talk to people. And we also said, if you're not interested in any of those things, if you don't care, then we will start campaigning against us, against you. And this is what, you know, this is who we are. And so, sometimes they would get those letters and be like, yeah, let's talk. Sometimes they would be like, oh my God.
They'd go on Google and be like,
holy crap, I don't want to deal with these people.
And they would cancel right away.
Or some of these large corporations were like, we don't give a crap about you. These whole like grassroots kids running around the streets causing problems. And then they realize, holy shit, like a year later, this is costing us millions of dollars and it's not worth their time or money anymore, and they drop the contracts. The idea of like what was
not
permissible in the campaign
was a very
difficult thing.
Because we very much
wanted to keep it non-hierarchical. We wanted to keep it horizontally organized.
And meaning that we weren't going to tell anyone what they could come down to.
For us personally, we believed in
non-violence. We didn't believe in using, we didn't believe in the use of like physical attacks on anyone. That was something we would support
or be a part of or
anything.
And as an organization, as SHAC USA, we would only engage in legal demonstrations. So we only organized legal demonstrations. A lot of times we worked to get permits, and sometimes we worked with the cops to be like, hey, this is where we're going, this is what we're doing, so we can keep it very above board.
But
our webpage operated much like a newspaper, except for we were a lot more vocal and editorialized more. But
anyone
and everyone that participated in the campaign could send us an email and be like, this is what we did.
So we
would get literally thousands of emails over the course of like 5 years of people that would be like, 10 of my friends went to this business in San Francisco. We did a demonstration, we yelled for an hour, and this is what we did. And then we would put it up on our webpage. Other
people
would be like, oh, we wrote letters today and like sent it to this laboratory. And we'd be like, great, we put that up on our webpage. Some
people
would write anonymous and be like, we smashed out this guy's windows. Like, okay, put it up on the webpage.
So
we had this policy of like putting everything up on the webpage. If
nothing more than
we're just reporting on what this movement was doing. And we didn't always agree with those things. A handful of times we really felt awful about them and wishing it never happened, and we had a lot of like internal discussions about like, God,
house is fucking awful, and we don't want to put this up there. But also, so, it was like, how does this, I think that's
one of the big
questions you have to have when you run, like, a non-hierarchical or a more essentially organized or something rooted in anarchism, that if there is no leaders, who gets to decide, like, what should or should not be reported on, for instance.
Is that
our place to censor your, what you feel is the right thing to do? And that was like a really tough decision that we had to do on a handful of times. We didn't always make the right decisions. One thing we always said about the SHAC campaign, for instance, was that this had never really been done before. And it was wildly successful. It caught on like wildfire, and it took off. It was in 18 countries around the world. It's just thousands and thousands of the refugees after just doing anything and everything to shut down this laboratory. And it was beyond any of our control. Like, it was out there. And I totally lost my train of thought of what I was going to say. But you could not control what people were doing. And people were going to make decisions to do things. And it was up to us basically to say, do we report on it or do we not? And that was a difficult part of the campaign for sure. I don't know what I was going to say. This had never been done before. So we didn't know what was going to work or what wasn't going to work. So it was basically like you just throw the wet pasta at the wall and see what sticks. Like, you just don't, and like, something's going to stick and something's going to fall on the ground and be disgusting and like, you don't do that yet. But like, you just make it, you just trial and error. And
I think there's
importance in failing. There's importance in making mistakes and having things not work. Because then you get to learn from them. And then you get to tell other people, hey, I tried this and it didn't work. And hopefully you all can learn from that too. And I think, not to get on a totally random tangent, but I think that's really how we start building stronger movements. We start talking to people that have been doing this for a while and saying, hey, we want to try this. Have you done it before? Did it work? Did it not work? Did it not work? And if it didn't work, why didn't it? And if it didn't work, why did it work? And then more importantly, I think, talk to people in other movements from other organizing circles and say, have you done these type of things before? And I think that's how we start building stronger and more important and better.
Just to add to that, do you keep track of these trial and errors, and is it open source working on site?
I mean, I don't know. Sorry. I mean,
there's
resources online. There's a webpage, for instance, called The Talent Conspiracy, which is a funny name, but on there has, like,
probably
the most comprehensive online library of radical animal rights and environmentalists, magazines, zines, newsletters, literature, sometimes videos. And like, if you want to know what a small
group
did in 1979 against the laboratory, you can go on there and if you look hard enough, you can find it. And it's really, really inspiring and really important, like, library of the history of movements that are important to us. And I would really like encourage everyone to just go and look at it. And sorry. Yeah, it's called the Talent Conspiracy. It's kind of weird. Like, talent, like conspiracy, like being tried as a terrorist in the United States for animal rights activism. Check that out. But
the other thing,
also, I think that's really important is to just talk to people. Like, there are people in this room that I know
done
activism for a really long time, and just, or even if
you
haven't done it for a long time, maybe you've been
doing it for 10 days.
You had the most amazing experience or the most awful experience. Like, let's just talk to one another and share ideas and feel comfortable with saying, like, hey, I tried this thing, it didn't work, or like, ask embarrassing questions, or come to these places and talk with one another, because that's how we start learning these things and becoming better at what we want to achieve. But if we all just stick to
doing
the one thing
over and over and over
again,
we never
question it, and we don't allow people to question it and say, hey, why are we still handing out literature and showing things on TV in town square
when
we've been doing that for 30 years and nothing's changed? Like, why do we keep doing it? Maybe we can try doing something different. Like, these are the conversations we have to have, and
they suck,
and they're hard to, like,
to admit,
like, man, I gave 5 years of my life, 7 years of my life doing this one tactic I thought was important, and now I'm like, man, maybe it didn't work, and I feel awful. But if we don't admit those things and allow ourselves to have those conversations, we can't reshape our movements to be better into the future. Sorry, I'm just going to ramble.
Are there more questions in the audience or comments?
Yeah. Alex. Yeah, just to add on what you just said in the end, Jake. So what are like ways and how we can really find out if what we do is effective? So for example, when you do like those campaigns against corporations and they shut down, of course it's obvious that it was effective, but how about like outreach or other strategies of like activism? Like are there any other ways in how we can like see if we're effective or not?
Yeah, I think that's a really great question, and I ask that a lot. How do you know you're really successful? I don't know. Okay, then why are we doing it? Like, if we don't have any measure of if we're being successful or not, we don't really know. And there's like so little time to waste with all the awful things going on in this world that we need to change. Like, to continue to do things that we just aren't sure. If it's making a difference, and we just don't know.
I mean, when it comes to like
broad animal rights issues, for instance, like we can look at, I think the indicator for being successful or not is how many animals are being killed every year. And that number continually rises every year, more or less goes up. And so the animal rights movement has been around more or less for like 100 years. And it's changed an awful lot, but that number is rising. And so I think it's important to look at like what we're doing in the animal rights movement
globally
and what's really popular and has that stuff been done in the past, and if it has been done, how come the number of animals being killed continues to rise? Are our numbers getting bigger legitimately? And can we tweak things to make it more successful and better? And the thing I really like, and I didn't get a chance to talk about this in my talk, but like the thing that's great about pressure campaigns, is you know when you win, right? And it might not be the best win, it might be a policy that you're like, meh, that kind of sucks, but at least it's like a step in the right direction. And those are really hard to take. I hate those. You know, I work for an organization where we have a policy, and I'm like, I'll shut these fuckers down. have to take step by step. And that's hard, but you can tell when you win. You can tell when you start shaping industries, when you start moving things. And people like that, like I said before, people want to win. So you have to give them things that they know that they're winning. And I think we have to be honest with ourselves about that too. And being real about what we're doing.
Sure, thank you.
Yeah.
Just there's one. Just essentially the animal rights movement, but also other groups working on political topics were very strongly influenced by digitalization. I think, like, over the last 10 years, or maybe the problems that they weren't, like, the rules of the game have changed a bit. And would you say that there has been some adapting to it, or rather, what should be the adaptation to that change? At least from the union point of view, the annoying thing about this issue is that, like, it also affects workplaces. Like, for example, the classical anarcho-syndicalist ideas that you organize your workplace, but what you do in companies where you don't have real workplaces, where, like, the place where the people go to every day and work at the same time and know each other and work there for years. And like the social space also disappears due to digitalization. And so, yeah, obviously, we, at least from our point of view, we have to build new places like this. But unfortunately, the new digital places where the social world and the work world take place are owned by some giant American corporations. So, we
really
are struggling with how to still have our place in this new world. We have, like, at least FAU has its own digital infrastructure. Like, FAU was the first German union to have a webpage, as far as I know. Yeah, that's why we own FAU.org, like a three-letter.org domain. Yeah, we are really proud of that. We don't have the resources to really. Like, we brought the trust, but we don't have the resources to grow at the speed that this new digital world has grown the other unions also quite suck a lot at dealing with the situation. So I think it's still like quite good, but there's still a lot of work to be done, and hopefully we'll find better ways of organizing in this new world, which also affects how people work and organize.
When you say like social media and stuff like that?
That people have different social spaces than before, and also theoretically the potential, like why don't we just try to get some messages around Android and use kind of tools?
Yeah. I work on like our digital team on 34 section network, so we do a lot of social media and web pages and videos and things like that. And I think the digital space can be like a really powerful tool, and you can do a lot of amazing things in it. But like any tool, like you have to know how to use it, right? And if you don't know how to use it, and you don't know how to like work the algorithms, for instance, like you just end up again like throwing that like toss against the wall, like nothing's really sticking. So I think like I can give examples like again, like for instance, like we hear a lot about like, oh, I did this video and like it's been seen 500,000 times and so on, therefore like that's a success.
But if
you know that like how Facebook works, for instance, like an average, like in order for a video to be counted as a view, someone only has to watch it for 3 seconds. And so like you could just be scrolling on your feed and like stop for 3 seconds, and that counts as a view.
And then
a majority of the views, according to Facebook statistically,
most people
only watch a video for 8 to 10 seconds.
So
you put up like, here's a 30-minute video of like us at like, you know, a slaughterhouse or something, or at a safe movement demonstration or something like that. Like, it's got 500,000 views,
but
the majority of people only watch the first 8 to 10 seconds.
So,
and another interesting statistic, I think, is that people only watch 85% of the views on Facebook are done without audio, so people aren't even listening to these videos. So, like, a lot of people love sharing these videos with people, you know, talking to people on the street about veganism, like, you know, these kind of like vegan celebrities that travel around the world and interview people on the streets, and these videos are like 20, 30 minutes long, and like, people only watch 10 seconds of them, and they're only watching them without sound. So, and the whole video is not talking. So, I think it goes back to your question, is like, how do you know you're being successful? I think a lot of people point to the statistics, well, I got 500,000 views, and therefore, if 10% of those people change into a vegetarian or vegan, like, you just don't know who's watching these videos, you don't know what the outcome is, and you don't actually know if they're watching them beyond 10 seconds or even listening to these videos. That being said, you can manipulate the digital space into your work for you, right? Make all your videos 10 seconds long, make sure they always have captions, make sure you get your point across that quickly, right? Like, and you can do it. People do it all the time. But if you can do it, then like you're going to be successful. So I think the digital space is hard because it gives you everything, like all the time. You're being fed information constantly. And like, there's so many movements and so many things going on in the world, and politics and personal life, that like people just cannot digest that much information that quickly. And so I think you just have to find ways to be smart and strategic about everything to make it work in your favor.
I have another question, or rather a challenge to your claim, maybe. So, as I understand you say, with campaigns we can measure success, with many other things like outreach or training individuals, we cannot really measure success, or we don't see that these things are successful. And my challenging claim would be with campaigns it's actually the same, so we don't know how we can, if we are successful like in every case, because one particular campaign might be successful, of course, that we can see, but then we don't know how the general consequences of that are. So, for example, from our experience, when we are successful in preventing one particular stable to be built or from keeping one stock house to be expanded, we can see that, but we don't see if that may just means that the same company moves to another place, so there are big facilities being built in Eastern Europe, for example, and they're also doing it partly because it gets harder and harder to build things here. So if we're actually harming the whole industry, it's totally unclear in my view. So that And in a way, I would also, I'm not so into it, but I would also say that that's true for some success in the environmental movement. So yeah, some companies, they step out of palm oil business, but then they use coconut oil, and then other companies come and as long as the whole principle and all companies have to produce more and compete against each other in place, then we might not really have that sort of success in general. And the same for turning people vegan, and then they don't necessarily get campaigners, but if they get campaigners, they might turn vegans. Yeah, but often it's not the case. So for example, when we work with local people against some sustainable slaughterhouses, a lot of them, or most of them, are not turning vegan, and they get more critical of animal agriculture, etc., etc. But then we don't really see that it has enough effect, even though we hope that it does. And there are many black pressures, if that's the right word, and also in the campaign thing. So we have this big campaign in Germany against fur, or we still have it, also concerted efforts, many groups active in a way that they always target one company, for example, and pressure them to not sell fur anymore, etc., etc. And that was very successful for many, many years, and still now we're seeing it a bit slowed down, like not so many actions, and in general, fur is just going up, so all these fur applications, they even have fur on shoes, yeah? So it's probably, we don't see that fur is actually being despised now, but it's as hip as so. So, what do you make of that?
Well, okay. Well, that's a lot to unpack. I'm really bad at multi-part questions, so I'll try to do my best. No, it's fine. That's my fault.
Not anyone else's.
And again, I just want to say that, like, these are my opinions, right? So, like, I can be right, I can be totally wrong, and I'm not trying to say, like, what I'm saying is fact, and I hope that people are challenging, but I appreciate the questions. I think the answers to some of the questions are, like, that
you keep
these industries on the run. And I think we heard this a lot in the SHAC campaign. Well, if you just close down this whole laboratory, they're just going to move to another country, or they'll end up testing in places like we heard this a lot. Like,
they're just
going to test everything in India. Like, they'll move everything in India. There's no animal rights movement there, and all these companies will just be able to run rampant in India and kill millions and millions of animals.
That's
a fair argument. I think, like, you just don't know what's going to happen. So, for instance, in India, they ended up banning animal testing on animals for cosmetics. So, like, all these cosmetic companies that people were like, oh, you're just going to move them to India, they weren't even able to operate there in 5 years anyway. So, I just think, like, you just never know. I think
for me,
I'm someone that's really into instant gratification. Like, I want to win now. I don't want to wait. But it's hard for me to say that, like, this is just going to take decades. Okay. Like, what we're trying to achieve is the biggest, loftiest goal of any social justice movement. And it's not going to happen in our lifetimes, and it's not going to, I don't think, happen in the next generation of like that. But I think if we keep pressuring these industries and moving them further and further into obscurity, I think that's really important. And I think, for instance, like,
they just put out a report
in Sweden like 2 days ago that, like, in 1961 there was like 1700 fur farms in Sweden, and now it's like 50. They're in China, but like,
industry
moves to China, then what's going to happen in China in 20, 30 years, 10 years, 5 years? Is there going to be an amazing animal rights movement in China? Like, you just don't know. And I would argue that, like,
yeah,
I feel like all this with China and, like, Chinese people don't care about animals. It's just kind of like not like an acceptable answer for a variety of different reasons. But I think that, like, the alternative of, like, oh, well, let's just let fur farms flourish in Sweden is also not the answer. I really think that, like, there are amazing animal rights organizations in places like China and places like South Korea and places where, like, a lot of, like, Western white folks are like, oh, they don't care about animals. I would argue there are actually lots and lots of people that care about animals in those countries. And I think they will, if they're not already, they will be doing or are doing amazing work for animals. And so I have
have faith in struggle and movement that way, no matter where oppression goes, there will be people there to fight it. And I think that's important to hold on to, and something I believe in. I'm trying to think about how you can measure success in corporate campaigns, and you just referenced Palm Oil.
I think the
Palm Oil industry has to get totally wonky in Palm Oil, because that's what we work on. I work an awful lot. I think a lot of people are
we need
to boycott Palm Oil, we need to get rid of Palm Oil.
But all that's going to do is just move,
like you said, companies onto another monocrop that's equally destructive or potentially worse than Palm Oil, like coconut oil or something like that. So for
the way we campaign, we don't
campaign to get rid of Palm Oil, we campaign for sustainable Palm Oil, which is a hard thing to do, but we think it's better off in the long run. And I'm not sure that type of campaigning can roll over into the animal rights world for some people. I think a lot of people don't want to fight for bigger cages, and I totally get that. I'm not super interested in that either. But the environmental sector, palm oil is oil that's used extensively by third world countries because it's cheap and it's easy and it's an important cooking oil and heating oil. It's also 50% of everything that we use in food, cosmetics, our cars, it's literally in everything, and you just can't point out of the way. And so I think being able to change sectors and making something more sustainable is a possibility, and making things better for the environment, for the animals that live in the environment, the indigenous peoples that live in those lands that are being decimated by the palm oil industry, and working and taking leadership from those indigenous people. I think we can create actual sustainable communities and corporations, I hate to say that, but around palm oil and other issues as well. I think it is possible, but again, it is that you gotta work really hard, and it's gonna take a really long time, and it's gonna take some compromises along the way, but I think eventually I think we can get there.
Okay.
We
just want to get rid of the stick. You know, like, we don't want to get rid of the circus, it's just a little stick.
And the government was like,
yeah, we don't want that in our town. We don't want people beat, you know. They showed undercover footage of elephants being beaten with these bull hooks. They had a couple elephant trainers come, or people that worked with elephants, and said, yeah, we don't use bull hooks.
And you know, they worked in, like, elephant sanctuaries and things.
And so the government was like, yeah, we're just going to get rid of the bull hooks. So they banned the bull hooks. The largest circus, I think, in the world, Brigham Brothers, I think, is the largest circus, or was the largest circus in the world. So we're just not going to bring our circus at all to Oakland. And that was the original point. Like, it was just like,
we
can find a strategic little pressure point with this bullhook and get rid of it. And it doesn't sound like it's about animal liberation, but the bigger picture is that they ended up banning the circus from coming to Oakland. Other cities in the United States started banning the bullhook.
Dog breeder there. It had its ups and downs.
but like that, they put enough pressure to the point where like politicians were coming out to Green Hill to be like, I have a favor for Green Hill closing too. And that was like almost a competition between politicians to see who could be more anti-Green Hill, to the point where like it shut down. I think that's, you know, like twisting politics to be like, to work for you is interesting. And they kind of did the same thing in Brazil, where they went after a laboratory, I think two laboratories in Brazil. They did the same thing. They actually mimicked a lot of the SHAC tactics and also the stuff using Green Hill, where they just like push, and to the point where like 1,000 people showed on the street that weren't vegetarian or vegan or omnivores, but they saw some of the camera footage that came in the laboratories and saw these dogs in horrible conditions, and they're like, we want this place closed. And like it turned into like a near riot at one point because the general population showed up and was like, we're not having this. And then the same thing, politicians came out and were like, I'm against this laboratory, no, I'm more against this laboratory. And I
believe
the laboratory is closed down, maybe, or they at the very least all the activists have to leave. They were like, we're not leaving this laboratory until you give us all the animals. And they did. And I think that's really interesting. And I think there's a lot of like, you know, and a lot of these things can't be replicated. Like, you can't be chef again, you can't do these breeder campaigns again, but you can take ideas and thoughts from each individual case and apply it in new ways. But it is like that idea of just trying every tool in the toolbox to figure out what works and applying pressure to where you're getting like interesting results.
People in the movement aware of that we need to organize like super internationally because of what you said basically. And how much is that recognized in the US? Because I mean it's not so typical for US people.
I mean, it's like such a country that is a huge country, I think. You can get different states to organize with one another. You know, 50 states, over 3,000 miles, sorry. Maybe it's a metric system, and I'm terrible at the metric system, but a whole thousands of kilometers wide. Like, yes. It's like
really.
I'm sorry, that was a super like American thing. So, but I apologize. But I mean, it's a massive country, and like it's hard to get people within states to even organize with one another. To get people organizing internationally, I think it really takes a lot of resources. I think there are like the bigger like animal NGOs in the United States. I think do it sometimes in good ways and sometimes in bad ways. I can't, it's hard for me to speak about anorexia in the United States because obviously I'm not in touch and involved with everything going on in the U.S. But I just think it's very, for the most part, pretty U.S. focused. And the only reason I can guess is just because it's so large. It's hard. I think with the digital age, like it's easier to communicate with people from around the world and that sort of thing. But I don't know, I don't really have a really solid answer for you, unfortunately.
More questions?
Is that your question? Was that your question? What time is it?
What happened? I wanted to be a member of the FAU once, but I was too poor. I did do it. I'm sorry, but I'm talking sometime. But as I understand, in the end, you FAU is against capitalism. And that's something, so you have does the FAU have an idea of a society that is without capitalism?
Yeah, that's another question up to now.
Moving over to the final segment.
No, I wanted to get to the intersectional part that if you have an idea of society that is without capitalism, without having to work 40 hours a week, without racism, sexism, poverty,
And how do you integrate that in the day-to-day work if you're actually just organizing five people to strike in a cinema? Is that an idea you have when you do that, or is it too much to incorporate that? I mean, when you talk about North Berlin, where you had a lot of workers from Eastern Europe that didn't have good contracts, maybe you had like the idea of structural racism too and incorporate that in a campaign. I don't know. Is that a question?
The thing with FAU is that we have some principles, but we are quite low level, so in order for everybody to be able to join, like, we obviously oppose racism and the like, but at the other end, we don't tell everybody who wants to join that they have to, sign into a certain agenda if they want to join. We have like some principles which are like meta in a way. For example, this politician part that you were talking about, this is like, this isn't really how the EU wants
things to work.
Yeah, okay, one can, politicians can do signing something, but we want to have workers organized and democratically develop their perspectives and their demands, and maybe delegate or like elect people with certain mandates to do stuff, but we don't want politicians in the end. Like, that's more about the process than about the content. But therefore, our small struggles try to follow this principle, and we have this feeling that this can scale up. Because it has this historic precedent with Spain in the 30s, like it's apparently possible to have an Anarcho Syndicalist Union at a larger scale than our current scale, and to be able to do that with the digitalization and like one can, it might be an easier scale up.
We
don't really say, like, okay, how does this collective agreement further our agenda towards the evolution of capitalism? Like, how many years is it from now? Like, maybe we are too modest in a way, but we have this, we are actually capitalists and we want to organize in ways which can survive the end of capitalism and maybe contribute to it, but it's not like our primary target to abolish capitalism within the next 5 years or something like that. And then we can also deal with animal liberation next step.
Yeah, I think that's a good idea. I would like to just respond a little bit more to you because I thought about it. And I was thinking about it too. I think that in my experiences, like, there's been a lot of like really interesting growth like internationally around campaigns. Like, for instance, the SHAC campaign, like I said, was involved in 18 countries around the world.
I think it's because
if you give people something exciting to latch onto, then people will start working together internationally. And I think we can see that today. Like, I think there's groups that like Anonymous for the whatever, the Voiceless or whatever it's called, they have like chapters all over the world. It's not something I'm terribly interested in, but I do think that like they do a great job of like gathering community and getting people involved, because I think it gives people, you give people the idea that you are part of a broader community, and I think people like that. And I think that that attracts people and allows people to organize internationally.
But yeah,
but I think you also see that a lot in pressure campaigns as well. Like, if you can get enough people around the world and a target that has abilities to be protested against in a variety of different countries, and you can make it exciting enough, and you can show the possibility of victory, I think people will also be drawn to that as well. And I think that's why SHAC worked so well, is because there are so many victories. Like I said, over 100 corporations, and people want to be a part of that. And so people, you know, just like a handful of people in the country, you're like, I'm going to do this, and then
instead of growing and growing and growing. So I think if you give people something interesting to do, they can feel part of the community and they can feel success, and I think it's easier to build an international movement. For sure, absolutely. Yeah, not the only one though. That's okay. I think it's happening and it needs to happen more for sure. Yeah. And it's just sad because I just like to talk forever, but like I also think it's important that we're working internationally, not just as the animal rights activists, but we start working with other communities and other movements and labor unions and everything, working together so that we can achieve our goals together. There's no reason that needs to be separate, so hopefully we can find a way to build bridges like that as well.
That was a great panel segment, I think. I would have more questions, but time's up. And, it's very late, and there was a long time. So thank you all for coming and for discussing, and we will be around to you a bit more, and so you can also talk to us if you want to join our group, because we also always want to grow and in order to avoid capitalism eventually. within 5 years. Thank you, Ben, and thank you, Jake, very much for coming and discussing and share all your thoughts. And that's it.